First John, it's towards the back of your New Testament, almost to Revelation, just a few books before that, but they're very short books, so just a couple of pages before the book of Revelation at the end of your Bibles. First John chapter 2. As you're turning there, I want to try something with you guys that maybe will backfire, maybe not. It all depends on how you guys respond. But let's do a quick fill-in-the-blank moment. I'm gonna start a phrase, and I want you guys to fill in the one word that's missing, okay? And the fun part about this is I'm gonna start easy, and we're going to go with familiar phrases and see how you guys do. So don't put all your eggs in one. See, you guys got this. We're good, right? We're good. Actions speak louder than. Perfect. Kill two birds with one. Stick, rock, what? Stone. All right. Imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. Okay, you got it. You got it. So that last one is one that I you know, we hear these phrases all the time, and you wonder a little bit about them. And most phrases that we toss around like that have some background to them, and they make logical sense and that sort of thing. So like, don't put all your eggs in one basket. It's because they could bash around into each other, break open an egg, and then you lose it, or you drop the basket, you lose all of them, and all of that sort of thing. Actions speak louder than words. You know, we as parents understand that. You can say all you want to, this is what you need to do to your children, but unless you demonstrate certain things in their life, they're not going to live that direction or that way. We get the idea behind that. The killing two birds with one stone, I've never done that before. I would love to say that I have, but I have not. I want to see one of you kill two birds with one stone. Not a bullet, by the way, Sean or Bradley or whatever. One stone. I want to see it. But, you know, I understand the idea there, you know, multiplying your output by minimizing your input. That would be great. But that last one, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. I don't know that I like that phrase. Because, I mean, I agree with it to some degree, but I also, I don't like the word flattery, I guess, is the, you know, because if somebody's imitating you, you know, then that is, I almost take that as a mark of respect, that they see something in your life that they want to imitate and make a part of their life because they respect that. But then I hear the word flattery and I think, well, it's just surfacey, it's not deep, it doesn't really mean anything. But I think if somebody is truly trying to imitate somebody else, there is this respect or acknowledgement that there is something in that person or individual's life that we want to gain in our own life. Do you agree? Yes? No? You guys follow me? Are you awake today? Well, in this passage of scripture that we're going to read today, in 1 John chapter 2, we're going to take a look at something that maybe comes along with what I just explained. Verse 3, we begin and we read, "We know that we have come to know him, that is Christ, if we obey his commands. The man who says, 'I know him,' but does not do what he commands, is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But if anyone obeys his word, God's love is truly made complete in him. This is how we know that we are in him. Whoever claims to live in him must walk as Jesus did. Dear friends, I'm not writing to you a new command, but an old one, which you have had since the beginning. This old command is the message that you have heard. Yet I'm writing to you a new command. Its truth is seen in him and you, because the darkness is passing and the true light is already shining. Anyone who claims to be in the light but hates his brother is still in darkness. Whoever loves his brother lives in the light, and there is nothing in him to make him stumble. But whoever hates his brother is in the darkness and walks around in the darkness. He does not know where he is going because the darkness has blinded him." Once again, Father, I come before you, and I just want to lift these words to you, that you would reveal yourself in them. God, that we would see your character and your nature, and that, God, you would transform our hearts and mind to be more like yours. God, because that is the desire here. We're not here to hear beautiful words from me, because that would not happen. We're not here to just be entertained by any means, but God, we're here to know you and to know you more. We're here to worship you because we're your children and we love you. And so, God, as we look to this passage of Scripture and as we look at some other references today, God, we just pray that you would open our hearts and our minds to it. Help us to be transformed more and more into your image, into your likeness. God, this is my prayer. I pray that the words of my heart and the meditations of my the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be acceptable in your sight. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. You know, imitation is something that we look at it and we understand, as I've already explained, this phrase, imitation is the sincerest form of flattery. It's something that we see in them that we respect and we want to imitate it. And in some ways, we strive after that to maybe one degree or another. We like it when people like the things that we like. And we like it especially when maybe our children follow in the direction that we're going to follow. I mean, I just recently started helping at the orthodontic office with Aaron, I almost called you Dr. Riley. And one of the first things I heard when I started working there with them is the ladies were talking about, because it's almost all women, her dad excluded, was how proud her dad was that his daughter was now an orthodontist with him in the same office. Now, that's right into this piece of what I'm talking about is we love it when our children or when others try to emulate things that we are proud of or that we have striven for. In the same way, Jesus himself, when he teaches his disciples, he not only taught them with words of what they should do, but he also numerous times would do things and then ask them to do those actions. For example, in John chapter 13, as he is in the upper room with the disciples and he is washing feet, right before the Last Supper, right before he's going to be arrested and crucified. And we know the story, or we remember the story probably, and he's down there washing their feet, and when he's all done, he's washed all of the disciples' feet, including Judas, who's about to betray him. He washes their feet, and then when he gets up, the first words out of his mouth is, "You should do this as well. You should do this as well." Now, he's not asking Peter to get up and wash everyone's feet all over again right then and there. He is asking them to imitate what he is doing, and he goes on to speak about how we are to serve others and not seek to be served. And so Jesus, he not only teaches them to imitate himself, but he also demonstrates for them valuable ways in which they can live that out and imitate him. And so I would argue that maybe the fundamental teaching of all, the most fundamental teaching in all of Christianity is that we need to be more like Christ. Would you agree with that statement? We need to be more like Christ. And that sounds so simple, but it is so not simple to live out all of the time. Do you know what I mean? There are moments in our Christianity where we seem to wander away or we lose focus of this idea of becoming more like Christ, and instead we would rather that Christ would become more like us. What do I mean by that? I mean, sometimes in our life we get certain things that are important to us, and we put all of our energy into that thing, and then we wonder why God's not blessing it, because sometimes he doesn't care about that thing. It might not be a bad thing. It might be a good thing, but if it's not his thing, then he's not going to come on board with it just because we are. But rather, God wants us to imitate him rather than transforming him into a God that fits our mold and fits into what our plan is. So this fundamental teaching of all of Christianity that we need to be more like Christ, it's super complex sometimes. Well, let me demonstrate this. Bradley, come on up here, would you, bud? And just for kicks and giggles, so you're not by yourself, Tyler, would you come up here? See, I'm picking people that I know aren't afraid to come up. And Matthew. Three people. And we're going to play a little game. How about all three of you stand over there, because there's more room over there. We're going to play a little game that I'm sure you guys are familiar with, and I'm sure you guys as the audience are pretty familiar with. Can you face me? And we're going to play a game called Simon Says. You guys have heard the game Simon Says, right? And so you know the understanding of Simon Says. When I do something, you guys are to imitate it if I say Simon Says. But if I don't say Simon Says, then you don't have to do the action, right? We know the game. Everyone understand the rules? Okay. So Simon Says, stand on one foot. All right. You can put it down. Oh, good job, guys. No one put it down. Awesome. So you heard what I said, but you didn't imitate what I did. See, and in our Christianity, you can go ahead. Simon says you can put your foot down for a minute, just for a moment. See, in our Christianity, sometimes we think, oh, it's as simple as doing the things and acting a certain way and just listening for, but there's more complexities to it because as we grow in Christ, maybe at the beginning when we first become Christians, God calls us to do things that are hard sometimes, but maybe not as hard as sometimes when we've walked with him for several years. And so let's continue our game of Simon Says. Simon says, stand on one foot. Simon says, pat your head and rub your belly. Now we're getting a little more complex. Simon says, stop. Simon says, start. Stop. Start. Oh, we're playing the game good. Simon says, jump while doing... See, it gets more complex. You guys can... Simon says, you can stop. It gets more complex as the game goes on. And it's a childhood game, and the idea is to knock somebody out from the game until there's only one person remaining. But what do we do if God says to us, hey, Simon says, blah, blah, craziness. We're like, I don't think I can do it exactly like that, God. Can you guys do that? All right, thanks for your volunteering, guys. Appreciate it. Volunteering as I called you up here. Simple demonstration, but the point is, in our Christianity, sometimes God asks us to do things that we're pretty easy and comfortable to do. But sometimes as we watch God's life and as we want to be imitators of God, we realize that the job becomes very complex. And there's times in our life and there's times in my life as a Christian when I look at certain passages of the Scripture and I feel like I can't live up to it. Let me give you an example. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5 says, your attitude should be the same as that as Christ Jesus. Jesus' attitude. Let's pin that one down. What is his attitude like? His attitude is pretty interesting. And my attitude, let's see, is very much not the same as his sometimes. I don't know if you can relate to that, but there are times in my life where my attitude just doesn't quite line up with his. But the truth of it is that should still be my goal. To imitate Christ in my very attitude, the core of my being. So it shouldn't just be what I do, those crazy actions of Simon Says. It shouldn't just be in the physical what I do, but it should be in the attitude of what Christ's attitude was. I referenced already John chapter 13 when Jesus is washing the feet of his disciples. I would argue that maybe Jesus, when he said to them, do as you have seen me do, and that you should serve one another, he was less interested at how many feet Peter would wash in his future. He was less interested in how many feet James would wash. He was not as much interested in the tally mark of them washing feet as he was interested in them understanding his attitude, which is to serve others, to place other people as more important than themselves and reshift their whole focus to recalibrate so that their first intention is to seek and to serve those around them and not to seek and to serve after self. I don't know, maybe I'm wrong in that. Maybe Jesus literally wants us to be washing feet every Sunday, but we don't do that in the church because I think we understand that the Scripture is more about the attitude that Jesus was demonstrating and wanting his disciples to follow than that specific action. Do you agree? Are we awake? Are we still there? I also look at another passage of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 5, beginning with verses 1 and 2, and I find this one struggling to myself as well, although it fits right in. It says, be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love, just as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us as a fragrant offering and a sacrifice to God. That verse, in essence, just tells us to mimic or be imitators of God in one specific area, and that is to love the same way that Jesus loves. And that sounds simple. But if we're really being honest with it, and the fundamental teaching of Christianity is that we need to become more and more like Christ, then we need to understand that includes the attitude, but it also includes this emotional side of us, and that we are to love the same way Christ loves. And as simple as that sounds, if we're being real honest here, just like my attitude doesn't always line up with Christ's attitude, my love falls far short of Christ's love. Now, what that means, what I mean by that is simple. I love my wife. I love my kids. It is really hard for me to say that I love a pedophile that I come in contact with downtown as much as I love my wife or kids. And I don't think any of us would make that connection and say, yeah, I love this individual who is doing all of these things to harm other people as much as I love my child or as much as I love my parent. But Christ loves each of us the same and unconditionally. We don't earn his love by good behavior or good deeds. He just lavishes his love on us. And so when I read this passage of Scripture, Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2, and it tells us to be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, to live a life of love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, that we should love other people in that way, I'm willing to bet that he wasn't indicating that we should just love our spouses that way. I'm willing to bet that he wasn't indicating that we should just love our family that way, or our coworkers that way, or your best friend that way. Because Christ didn't love just those individuals that way. He loved all of humanity that way. And so when we look at this foundational teaching of Christianity, to become more like Christ, I'm challenged by it. In the midst of all of this, I have to ask, so what does it mean? What does this really mean? What does it look like to be like Christ? Is it all about doing what he does? You know, last week I talked about how I can't walk on water. I can't do what Jesus does. Or is it more about thinking what he thinks? Being motivated by what motivates him, being transformed not only in the action side of it, and that is important to follow the things that Jesus asks us to do, but also to be motivated inside to take on his nature. And to understand how to take on his nature, I need to first understand who God is, who the Son of God is, who is Christ, that he's asking us to be imitators thereof. Now, I'm going to pause right now, and I'm going to tell you, even as I'm asking this question, we would be here forever for me to explain who all God is, all of his attributes, all of his character, all of his nature. I can't cover it. I can't even cover the few that I'm going to cover in fullest detail. Because he's God, and he's amazing, and he's far beyond our understanding and our grasp. But I want to take a look at a couple of characteristics of God that we see demonstrated in Scripture that we should be imitators of, his attitudes, if you will, that drive his actions. The reason that God does what he does is based on some of these key attributes of who he is. And these are things that not only we should emulate and imitate about God, but these are things that actually Scripture tells us we have to. And so let's take a look at a couple of those real quick. First, one of the things about God that we need to understand is that Christ was humble. And we, as his followers, as his children, need to be imitators of Christ. We need to be humble as well. Humble. Philippians chapter 2, I read you that one verse, but let's look at a few verses in connection with it. Your attitude should be the same as that as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant and being made in human likeness. You see, at the very core of who God is, even though he is equal, he is part of the Trinity, even though he was fully God and all-powerful God, he humbled himself and became nothing. The king of all of creation was born in a stable. I know that sounds Christmassy, but it's still true. The king of all of creation was crucified on a cross. People tore out chunks of his beard as Roman soldiers, and they whipped him and spat on him. The king and creator of all things humbled himself. In the same way, not only was he born in a manger, not only was he spat upon and crucified, but that same king of all creation, he interacted with people in a very humble manner in between those two moments. That same king and creator washed feet, absolutely, as we've already mentioned. That same king and creator sat down with prostitutes, tax collectors, people that everyone else wanted to reject. that same King and Creator. He did many awesome and great things, but he was so humble. He was willing to go to the naked, literally. He was willing to cast out those demons and those who had been rejected by society. He humbled himself. Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, Jesus' words, he says to his followers, he says, "Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and am humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." At the very core of Christ calling us to take on his teaching and to follow him, he gives us his core attributes that he wants us to understand. He's saying, come, follow me, you're going to find rest for your very weary souls. You're going to find renewal and you're going to find newness. But first, understand that I am God and I am gentle and humble. In the Old Testament, this idea of taking up a yoke, we demonstrate it with a yoke and of oxen, where they are linked together by a heavy wooden structure that goes over the two oxen, and it holds them together as they pull a plow or a cart or whatever it is that they are doing. And it is a yoking together so that they can labor together. And absolutely, the Hebrew here is referencing that for sure on one level. But on another level, there is this idea that has been taught throughout Hebrew history that when somebody is a great teacher or someone is a great demonstrator of godness, like Samuel in the Old Testament or something of that nature, then people would take on that person's yoke, which literally means their teaching, their platform, if you will, if we want to get a political statement in there about it, their platform of teaching, that person would subscribe to that and submit to that yoke or that teaching concept. And so when Jesus says, "Take upon you my yoke," he is referencing for sure oxen pulling together, and he's saying, "I'm God, I'm going to pull right alongside of you, and I'm going to bear the brunt of this load," absolutely. But he is also saying, the core of my teaching, you need to take upon your life and apply it if you want to be a follower of me. And what is that core? He defines it even as he's asking you to take up the yoke. He's saying, come, take up this yoke. And what is the yoke? I am gentle and humble of heart. And that is what God is asking us to imitate in him. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8 says it this way: "Finally, all of you live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic. Love as brothers and sisters. Be compassionate and humble." I think, and I could, like I said earlier, go on and on and on about each of these attributes. But I think maybe I've shown you a little bit, not only that God himself in the form of Jesus Christ was humble in nature, but he is asking us, he is desiring, he is even, dare I say it, commanding us as his followers that we need to be humble. Why? Because God is humble. That's who he is. We want to be children of God. We want to bear the name of Christ. We need to act as Christ. We need to, if you will, live up to the name. And part of that is the humbleness. I find it interesting, when we talk about the opposite of humbleness, people oftentimes think that pride is the thing that gets in the way of humbleness. And maybe that's part of it, but I would argue that maybe some of what gets in the way of us being humble is our ignorance. Or maybe put it a different way, the opposite of, or the way to combat pride in your life is not to become humble, because we can't just say, "I'm going to become humble," and then become humble. We have to practice and learn how to become humble, and that comes through knowledge, the knowledge of who we are. When we have a proper knowledge of who we are and who God is, and understanding that I can't do any of these things on my own, but God himself can and will and desires to do those things. Then we become humble because we realize that it is God and God alone. Next, and this list of characteristics that we not only see demonstrated in the life of Christ, but we see teaching over and again that we need to be imitators thereof, is the nature of God is not only that he is humble, but God is also loving. It's one thing to be humble and still be spiteful, but God is not that. God is humble in his nature, powerful, absolutely, but he is also loving in his nature. Ephesians chapter 5, verses 1 and 2 says it this way: "Be imitators of God." We've read this passage already, right? "Be imitators of God, therefore, as dearly loved children, and live a life of love." There it is. right at the core, we're not only following God and who he is and what he says at a blanket statement, but understand there's specifics. God is love, absolutely. And if we as Christians cannot love, then what can we do? You know what I'm saying? Now, I've already said at the very beginning that that passage of Scripture is challenging to me because there are times in my life where I love, absolutely love people no matter how much they've hurt or done things wrong or things I don't agree with, absolutely. But then there are other people or other times in my life where I'm not feeling so loving. Do you know what I'm saying? And when you're confronted with somebody who's in the mess of their sin, it is one of the hardest times to love them. And yet, it is in those times when we are stuck in the mess of our sin, it is in the ugliness of all of that when Christ's love is so overwhelming to us. Who are we, if we call ourselves Christians, who are we to deny love in somebody's sin-sick soul when Christ is lavishing it out? We want them to look a certain way, act a certain way, or be a certain part before we give our love. But God doesn't do that. While we were yet sinners, that's when Christ dies for us, which is the fullest extent of his love. We are to be imitators of God, and it's very clear that we are to live this life of love all of the time, that we should love others unconditionally, whether they deserve it or not. Whether they've harmed you or not, whether you've forgiven them or not, whether they deserve it or not, God loves. God loves. Matthew chapter 5, verses 43 through 45 says it this way, "You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies as well, and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be sons of your Father who is in heaven." You see, at the core, at the very core of Jesus' teaching, this is the Sermon on the Mount, one of his first and biggest sermons recorded in all of Scripture. At the very core, in the very beginning of all of it, he's saying, listen, I get it. You can love the person that you care about, but I'm telling you something even greater. Love even those who persecute. Love those who are your enemies. Pretty strong word. I don't know that I consider myself to have many enemies, but if I did, God wants me to love them anyhow. Mark chapter 12, verses 30 and 31, we read, "Love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your mind and with all of your soul." Now, this is Jesus' response to the Pharisees. They're asking him, what is the greatest commandment? At that moment, reading through just that verse, stopping where I stopped, which is not all of the verse, it is quoting, Jesus is quoting directly from Deuteronomy chapter 6, what is called the Shema. It is one of the core tenets of Hebrew faith that is taught to children from the moment that they can start speaking, to memorize and to quote the Shema. Matter of fact, the Hebrew culture says that once a year, the men in the Hebrew culture are to take a leather strap that has the Shema written out it, and they are to bind it around their arm and up around their forehead, and they are to walk a whole day like that. It is to remind them to love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your mind, and with all of your soul. That word is to be written on their doorposts or their homes, it tells us in Hebrews or in Deuteronomy chapter 6. But Jesus, he takes that and he goes another step. In verse 31, we read this, the second command. The Pharisees asked for one, and he tells them, love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, and soul. He says, and second, love your neighbor as yourself. At the core, the greatest command is to love God, seconded by the love everyone. Core of who Christ is, the core attribute. If we are wanting to be like Christ, we need to be humble and we need to love. That is at the core. We cannot move forward in Christianity if we do not have love. That is the foundation. That is the cornerstone, if you will. But continuing on and building on that, if you will, we find that right after that, in numerous times in Jesus' life, we find that there is this call for another attribute to be taken into our life and that we should be imitators of. We should be humble in spirit, humble in action, absolutely. We should love others unconditionally, absolutely. And that builds within us compassion. There are numerous times when Jesus, he is doing ministry, and there are times that it indicates that he is absolutely exhausted. And then he sees the crowd, and instead of giving in to his exhaustion, what he does instead is he has compassion on the crowd because they are like sheep without a shepherd, to use his own words, or they are struggling in a situation. And so he goes in, and even though he's exhausted, he begins to heal and he begins to teach and he begins to just love the people. And if we are to be his children, if we are to be the sons and the daughters of Jesus Christ, if we are to be Christians, then we need to love others in a way that manifests itself in compassion. That we would see not only that we need to love them, but we would see that their need needs to be met. Matthew chapter 9, verse 36 and 37, Jesus, he sees the crowd, he has compassion on them because they were harassed and helpless. Do we see people at Meijer, people at work, people at in our community, in our neighborhood as harassed and helpless? Because if we could see them with the eyes of Christ, that's what he would see. Now, when Jesus was seeing this, he didn't see Roman soldiers standing there physically harassing the people. That's not the harassment he was talking about. He was talking about a harassment in their spirit, a lack of knowing God, and this harassment of Satan who was there. And guess what? That is still alive and active in our world. People all around you are harassed and needing God's compassion manifested through you because they are harassed and they are helpless without the knowledge of who Christ is. At the core of Christ, we find humbleness. At the core of Christ, we find love. At the core of Christ, we find compassionate nature. In 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 8, we finally read this. Live in harmony with one another. Be sympathetic. Love as brothers. Be compassionate and humble. That is the voice of encouragement to the church from Peter. He's saying, listen, this is the attitude of Christ we need to have. We need to do these things. We need to love as brothers. We need to be compassionate. We need to act humbly. And then as we continue on building, if we understand the humbleness of God and we can try to strive after that and we seek to live out the love of Christ in our life and we then open our eyes and have compassion for those around us, what we also see is that God is wanting to transform from within and make us a holy people. Now, that doesn't mean perfect. Understand me. I'm not going there. I'm not perfect. I think you all know that by now, right? I'm not perfect. And none of us are perfect. And no one expects you to be perfect, or they shouldn't, I should say. And so when I say this word holy, it's a word we don't use out in the regular world very often. It's only what we use in reference to Christianity. But the idea is that God is wanting to make you into his image. He is wanting to craft you and transform your mind, your spirit. He is doing the work. And what he is doing is creating within you something far greater and set apart for his kingdom. And so understand that the nature of who God is love, absolutely, but it is also this holiness that has no room for sin. It has no room for sin. Christ himself was without sin. And I'm not saying you're without sin. I'm not saying I'm without sin, because actually Scripture says that we all have sin. And we all fall short of the glory of God. But what I am saying is this, is that God calls you to be his child. He wants to siphon out of you, if you will, this sin nature that is in us. Romans tells us that we don't have to be slaves to sin any longer, because God can take that out, that desire and that crave for sin, and he can replace it with a slaveness, if that's even a word, to righteousness. He wants to replace within us this selfish living and this sin nature that is bred into us from the very fall of humanity in the Garden of Eden, and he wants to replace it with a holiness that is only God. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 and 4 says, praise be to God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us in the heavenly realms with every spiritual blessing in Christ. Are you ready for this? For he chose us in him before the very creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. God chose you before all of creation to be holy and blameless in his sight. He created humanity without sin. That was his original design, and he chose you for this very moment and this very time that we could come back to him and live lives of holiness if we just surrender to what he is doing in our lives, because that is his nature. Hebrews chapter 12, 14 and 15 says, make every effort to live at peace with all men and to be holy, because without holiness, no one will see the Lord. Or 1 Peter says, as obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you have lived with in ignorance, but just as he who has called you is holy, so you should also be holy in all that you do. For it is written, be holy because I am God and I am holy. Ephesians chapter 4, verses 22 to 24 says, you were taught with regard to your former way of life to put off your old self, which is being corrupted by its deceitful desires, to be made new in the attitude of your minds, and to put on a new self, created to be like God in true righteousness and holiness. But see, therein lies some of the issue. If we are not humble, if we are not allowing God's love to manifest in us, if we don't realize his compassion on our soul, then we tend to not strive after his holiness because we think we have to do it, and we know that we cannot. But the truth is even as God has called us to be holy, even as he's demonstrated his holiness, even as he has given us the power of his Holy Spirit to be holy, we need to come to terms with the fact that it is him who is holy, and he will be the one who makes us holy. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, Paul says it this way. He says to his people as he's writing to the church of Thessalonica, he gives them these quick-fire things. He says, be thankful always, and everything give thanks. He says, pray continually, which I feel is like a pretty big thing there to understand and to wrap our minds around. He goes, do not put out the Spirit's fire, which again is just like this huge thing that God has, these quick verses of how we should live. And then he says in verse 23, he says, by the way, the one who started the work in you, the one who you call on, he's faithful and he will complete the work. So even as God is telling us that we should act this certain way, the only way for us to act that way is to surrender and allow him to do the work in us. We can try all we want to be humble. We can try all we want to be loving, and we will fall short. We can try all we want to have compassion, and there'll be that moment when it's not there. We can do all of these things, but if God is not in it, it doesn't matter, and it will fail. However, if we seek the nature and the character of God and we surrender to his will and his way and allow him to work in us, what we find is that God does that transforming work and he sanctifies or sets us apart. He makes us holy. He fills us with his love that we can't explain. He gives us his compassion for those around us that we cannot understand, and he gives us a humbleness that we cannot manufacture or mimic on our own. And so when God calls us to be imitators of him, When Christ demonstrates how we should live, what he's asking us to do, as complex as it may be, he is really simply saying, I need to live in you. So I'm going to have the praise team come on up here. We're going to go into a time of communion. And I just want to encourage you. I want to encourage you that God is seeking not perfection of our own manufactured nature. He is just seeking for us to be vessels that seek his nature. Because then he can build that in us. He can fill us with his nature. From the top to the bottom, from the in to the out, he wants to do that work in you. And so as the praise team is going to play and lead, when you are ready, come on up and take communion. It is just a symbol that God is doing the great work of forgiveness in your life. Father God, we come to you and we want to give thanks because you are God and you love us so much that no matter what, you sent your son, even while we were still sinners, and you shed your blood for us. Your body was broken for us, and we give thanks for that. And so now as we partake of communion together as a body of believers, God, may we do so in remembrance of the greatness of who you are, but also knowing, God, that this is a new covenant of your blood in us, that your Holy Spirit can now dwell in us and save our very souls. And we thank you for that. We pray in Jesus' name.